technical hacker. So Arseny comes from Moscow. He flew in just recently. And he is the head of research at a company called Positive Technologies, which develops web application firewalls and lots of other exciting stuff. So today Arseny has prepared a presentation to talk about some evil Chrome extensions. So if those of you who use Chrome browser think this is the best and the most secure browser in the world, this will make you think again. So once we sort out the technical problem, yep, I'm getting HDMI plugged in. And just before I say so, both our main speakers flew in from abroad. So Kevin came from Canada and Arseny from Moscow. This is the first time I have both speakers arriving on the day for OWASP. So I'm really grateful. I think it's just a miracle that both managed to be here on time. So there you go.
Okay, thank you, Sam. Hello, everyone. My name is Arseny Reutov, and my topic is post-message security in Chrome extensions. So a little bit about myself. I'm a web application security guy at Positive Technologies. Our company supports OWASP as well. The last OWASP meetup Russia was held and was organized by our company. I'm also a member of Positive Gays Conference board. This is the conference that we organize in May in Moscow. You should definitely visit it. And I'm an occasional web security blogger at razor.net. So before we start, maybe some of you heard about the RCE in last past Chrome extension that was discovered by Chavis Armandio of Google Project Zero. Yeah. If you have seen the exploit and read the advisory, you should have the idea, general idea of what this talk will be about. So my talk is divided into five parts. Firstly, I will talk about Chrome extensions and their structure, how they are organized, and what messaging they use. Then I will cover post-message security. Why, what is bad, how we should properly use it. Then I will talk about the research steps of Chrome extensions that I did just recently. So the next are the results and the takeaways. So the first part, Chrome extensions. Well, I guess that everybody of you know that Chrome Web Store is a source of malware, and you should be very accurate when installing extensions. The Chrome Web Store itself has a bad UI because its Gilex are not good in terms of security. They do not provide insight into what this extension is about. And when you install an extension, you just blindly click add extension. And if you pay attention to the permissions that this extension requests, then you will see that this extension effectively has possession of all your tabs, of all your pages, all your contacts on all websites. So this is the structure of a Chrome extension. In the inner layer, there is DOM, Document Object Module. In this space, an extension can inject its content script, and a content script can communicate with other scripts on the page via PostMessage API. An extension also has some background script that runs in background, and the content script can communicate with background script via message passing API. And digging further, the extension can also communicate with OS via native messaging API. So potentially, if you have some vulnerability in the content script, the malicious payload can reach native messaging API. So potentially, you can execute any comment on the target computer. Every extension has a manifest file. It looks like this. It consists of the name, the description, the version, the path to background script, and the list of content scripts with the definitions of which websites Chrome should inject these context scripts. And the last notable section of this extension, manifest file, is permissions list. So you will see that in majority of extensions, you will see just this definition that this extension requires access to all websites. So part two, post message security. So post message is a means of cross origin communications, because in document object model you cannot access the DOM of other websites because of SOAP, same origin policy. And people needed some way to communicate from, for example, iframes to parent frames for some reasons. And PostMessage was invented just for cross-origin communication within document object model. And you can see an example of PostMessage call. First parameter is the message itself, which can be a string, a number, an object, whatever. And the target origin, second parameter, this is can be considered as the destination of this message. The main pitfall of post message is that developer is in charge of origin validation, and there is no means of origin validation built in browsers. They do not provide it. So every developer should write some piece of code that will validate that this message is intended for this listener, which can be either by checking origin property on the event object, and you can check if the origin string is matches the provided string, or it can be checking the source parameter property on the event object. And you can check if the window source, the source is equals to the window reference. So if the window is from another tab or iframe, so you compare objects here, not strings. So the problem is that that not many, not all developers validate the origin properly. And if they fail to do it correctly, then the code can be executed, because the data can reach dangerous pieces of code. And there is a nice blog post by Matthias Carlson called People Solve Post Message. You should check it out. It contains a list of techniques that can be used to bypass origin validation. The two peculiarities of post message is that, unlike other DOM events, the message propagation to listeners cannot be stopped. So if you're a developer of some defensive JavaScript that is injected into the page, you cannot you can do nothing with these post messages. You cannot add your listener that will call stop propagation on event because post message just ignores it. And if a message is sent, then it will reach each listener to find. And another peculiarity that message listeners that are defined by content scripts in Chrome extensions are not listed in developer tools. So you cannot see which listeners are added by content scripts in your extensions. But if a content script injects another script and this script defines a listener, then you will see it. But in content scripts originally, there are, you won't see any message listeners in developer tools. So there are two main attack vectors when exploiting post-message attacks. The first one is are iframes. So the idea is simple, you just create an iframe with the source of the target page, and you just send this message using content reader property. Well, it's quite stealthy because user just doesn't suspect, he doesn't suspect anything, just done background, but iframes are killed by xframe options header and so-called frame busters. So it's not every target is suitable for this method. The second method is opening a new window. So using window open, you can create another page, another tab. You will see another tab pop up in your Chrome browser. But in this case, it requires some user interaction, because if you automatically open a window, then Chrome will detect it, and you will see in the top bar that some pop-up window has been opened, and Chrome will block it. So to in some way bypass it, you should add this code to the listener on, for example, a link, and put it into onload onclick event. So in this case, the user has to click this button, and the attack will succeed. So what about post message in Chrome extensions? I found out that Chrome extensions also use post message to communicate with developer tools of some frameworks. Also, post message is used in translator services and sites that require, that provide some service to the by the extension. So the obvious danger is that the data in post message can reach background script, and in some cases even reach OS. And if we find an extension that does not sufficiently validate origin, then nasty things can happen. So I decided to download some extensions from Chrome Web Store and check if some of these extensions actually use PostMessage and actually let this attack to happen, to not validate origin properly. So the third part, the research itself. So what I did, I download extensions, not manually of course, I wrote basic script in Node.js to do it for me. I chose web development category because I had some experience with web development tools in Chrome, and I figured out that this extension didn't validate origin properly. So I decided to prove my assumption that other web development tools for Chrome can be vulnerable as well. So I downloaded about 4,000 extensions. Extensions itself are not just archives, they are CRX files. In a nutshell, they are just a zip archive, but with some checksum injected, so you should properly parse it, convert it to zip, and unpack. So having all these extensions unpacked and having them on my hard drive as plain folders, my script just opened a manifest file in each extension and looked for content script definitions. So having these content scripts path, I could open them as well recursively, parse it with Acorn. Acorn is a JS parser written in JavaScript, of course, which allows to statically analyze JavaScript. So I wrote an Acorn plugin that looked for PostMessage listeners. So I called it PostMessage Scanner. And each PostMessage in content script was logged into local Elasticsearch. Elasticsearch is a useful database for storing object data like JSONs. It also has a nice UI called Kibana, which I use to simplify my research. So, and the results. Reactive tools. This is React. I think that many of you have heard about it. It's a framework, well, it's a new library by Facebook. It also has an extension for Chrome, and it was flawed in terms of PostMessage security. Just recently, a pull request was added, external pull request, that added proper validation, because prior to this fix, there was no validation at all. So you can see that what Facebook developers did, they just checked in the message a special property with the value reactive tools content script. And this property can be user controlled. And every website, a checker can send the message with this value. So the fix was just to check if the originating window is the same as the current window. So, and the fix is quite sufficient. Ember Inspector. Ember is another JavaScript framework. It also has an extension. Well, it's not, doesn't have much code base, but it has also a flawed PostMessage listener. As you can see, the protection was the same, if you can call it protection. It was just by checking a property that its value is debugger client. Any JavaScript can be changed as debugger client because it's user control. Fortunately, there were not any interesting things. I couldn't pass my data into some sensitive pieces of code. I could change the icon, but it was not interesting. So AngularJS veteran. It's an extension for Angular. Angular is another JavaScript framework. The exactly for the first version. So as you can see from the comments, the developers had absolutely no clue how to validate origin. I don't know why, but they thought that event source is equals to window for all messages, which is not true. So maybe at some point it was this way, but I tried it, and the event source property is actually the proper window, and you can check it safely. And you see that hopefully they check the property from veteran. And of course, any JavaScript can be from veteran. There is an extension called Augury, which is more interesting. It is for Angular, but version 2. This is a piece of compiled script. It's AngularJS, but you can see that the check source function is also flawed. It just checks if message source property equals to Augury inspect location. And again, anybody, every script can pretend is Augury. But this time it was more interesting because Augury uses some interesting message serialization. They call it serialization. What you see in fact is just evaluation of JavaScript. So you could just use a code like this. This is the proof of concept that evaluates that actually is an XSS on every website if you have this extension installed. So I guess you understand what happens next. You can pop up an alert on any website, for example, Google, of course. And this is the last extension. It's not a JavaScript framework this time. I didn't know what it is myself either. But from the title, I suspected that something could be wrong with this extension. You see that it has shell and execute, and I was quite suspicious what can happen next. And when I opened the source code, it was exactly what I thought it to be. So this LAN sweeper, which is some Windows software for managing LAN networks, in its extension for Chrome, adds a message listener that that accepts two parameters. The first one is the application. It should be a LAN sweeper, and the second parameter is a comment. And needless to say, this comment is executed. So you can execute any OS comment, just having your victim on your website on special captured page. So that's it. And I want to propose some steps for users. Of course, you should not install some extensions that look suspicious. You should always check the permissions that are requested. For developers, of course, you should properly validate origins. you should also consider bypass tricks, because if you implement it incorrectly, then hacker can bypass your checks. And of course, you shouldn't rely on matrix things, as you saw in this presentation. Just extensions are just especially developed tools. Just expect that nobody can send this Unix string, but of course, it's not true. And for browsers, I think that they should have some built-in protection. They should have some means to validate origins. And I really like get message proposal by Igor Homakov. You should also check out his post. So that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, you propose, I have a question, right? First question. You propose some very good things, right? You're saying, okay, users should check if extensions are not shady. And they're supposed to know that, right? So I don't like this suggestion. The second one, you said we need to talk to the browser manufacturers, right? So we need to talk to Google and tell, hang on guys, why are you allowing extensions which can run any command on the user's operating system? I saw your example was pinggoogle.com. But that could be format your C drive, or that could be copy your Outlook folder to Dropbox.com or whatever. So has any effort been done to approach Google and other browser vendors to actually fix this properly?
Well, at the last meetup of OWASP in Moscow, there was a talk about Chrome extensions. The speaker was from a popular social network in Russia, and she spoke about the problem of malware extensions, because as an application security specialist, she confronted the amount of users that had these extensions installed, and these extensions replaced the ads on their social network site, and they had big losses. And from her presentation, the summary was that there is no way actually to get the situation better. Chrome Web Store tries to moderate these extensions, but the effort is too little, and there are still a lot of malware extensions. And as a site owner, you cannot do anything with it, because if you, for example, have content security policy to your extension, then malware extension will just delete it and do what they want. And as for shady extensions, at least they do not.
Well, take it, right? We have a bit of intuition, right? So we say, this looks dodgy, like this LAN exec, shell exec.
At least it shouldn't have the shell and execution.
Of course, but that was giving up what it was doing in its name, right?
Yeah.
But, well, if someone installs an extension which says, I don't know, Google Docs offline helper, and inside it has one of these, that's it, it's good.
So, I used to work for a big e-commerce company, and we had some fun with extensions as well, because I'm not sure, you know, but one of the other ways you can install extensions is when you download something, like it used to be downloads.com. When you download something, it will add also adware and things on top of that, and those can be toolbars, and those also have control over the DOM. So what we've seen is that it will show you, it would look exactly like it's part of the website and says, find the cheaper deal here, and it will take you to a competitor. And what they would do is they would sell this functionality to competing websites. So, you know, if you're a competitor to Amazon or anyone else, then they would basically sell that functionality to drive revenue that way, and then you end up losing. The thing is, you don't see it at all. So one of the things I would have liked to have seen is by design, the extensions have more control over the page than the site owner. And so, and it's by design. I mean, you have like ad blockers. You don't want to be tracked. You put that extension on, fair enough. But what would also be nice is if we have something like the content security policy, that it just alerts you that, yeah, this extension has actually changed your website or so forth, so we get some kind of signals. But the other one, yeah, is you can't just run everything, including just format the drive. Would be a little bit helpful.
Yeah, that's true. According to the standard, it states that extensions have priority over the user scripts, and user is higher, and he can decide for himself what he wants to execute in his browser. So maybe this should be reconsidered.
Hi, great talk, thanks. Two questions. Do you open source the code that you use to fetch the extensions from the Chrome Store? Because I'd be very interested in doing some research in that area as well. It would be great if you could publish it somewhere, just to fetch the extension, parse them, and look for things. Second question is, Firefox recently is changing its extensions framework to match the Chrome's one. So I'm just wondering if other browsers like Firefox, Safari, have the same issues as you described in Chrome.
Well, as for Firefox, I heard that they are switching to the open. There is some standard for extensions. Open standard, and browsers are beginning to adapt it, and Firefox was
they copied the code from Chrome, actually?
Yes.
No.
So your research was just about
Yeah, it was just for Chrome, but I get that other browsers can have the vulnerability like this one. As for code, it's too ugly right now, but I didn't consider posting it, but
please consider posting it on GitHub.
Okay. I have a question. Do you know of a way to disassemble XPI files to identify extensions that could potentially contain this type of vulnerability?
Well, yeah, there is way to do it, and there was a talk at Black Hat in 2011, if I'm not mistaken. It was about exactly vulnerabilities in Firefox extensions, and PostMessage wasn't listed here, if I remember correctly, but there were way more disastrous consequences, because the extensions with millions of users also could lead to RCEs. It was back in 2011.
So if that's the case, do you know of any resources online that are like identifying extensions that contain this type of vulnerability? Like, is anyone maintaining a list somewhere?
I haven't heard, actually. I used my in-house parser on Acorn to do that. And I haven't found any means to do analysis. I guess that you could run static analysis tools on extensions, but I guess that these tools do not know that these extensions, about these extensions and how they interact and communicate about their structure, about background consciousness, so there are lots of glitches.
Cool, thank you.
Any other questions?
Cool. So if I hear correctly, so is there any group or anybody that's today checking these extensions for their security, and what happens when the security vulnerability is discovered? Is it just a report to Google and somehow those guys come and check it?
Yeah, I think that it just changed their mind right now. Didn't see any. Well, the research in 2011, I think it's the biggest attempt to analyze the extensions, but it was in Firefox. So as for Chrome, didn't see any.
So if Postman has a freaking backdoor, right?
That means that everybody is compromised.
So that's a really great OWASP project, actually. So because it's all JavaScript, so you can actually run that thing to a JavaScript analyzer. At least you can try to figure out some of the stuff there. So if you guys are looking for a nice OWASP project, so here you can take your code, right? and just basically start running through at least the top extensions, right? Because it's actually a massive risk. Because
yeah,
that thing, you know, that thing has access to all your websites. I think the thing that you didn't fully push is the idea that when it says, because I wrote an extension, right, and I was shocked with the power that you have, because that little thing that says this can modify the code, it actually it is. You know, that can go to every single frame, every single tab, and actually modify the code of that. So all our defenses, all our secure freaking websites, right, get compromised by just an extension, right?
Yeah, that's
so true. So that's
quite cool. Is it okay to name a vendor? I'm not working for that vendor. Okay, so I attended O'Reilly Security Amsterdam last winter, and there was person, CEO of Perimeter X, that was working on malware spreading as Chrome extensions. So the talk was really amazing. If you have a chance to see the recording, do it. The long story short, there's plenty of malware publishers publishing extensions in a Chrome store. They tend to stay under the radar. So they allow up to 50,000 people to download the extension, so they don't get caught by Google filters, and then they switch.
On that one, just to give you the real world example of this, right? What we're saying, actually, one of the companies I was working for, they were hijacking our brands, and they were creating Chrome extensions for those brands, and their business model was to inject ads and to inject click stuff, right? It's exactly that kind of business model that was based on that.
Chrome extensions are even used for DDoS attacks recently, so there are some campaigns using infected users with these malware extensions. I guess this is an emerging threat.
For the real hardcore users, we should be creating custom browsers, right? We should be taking Firefox or Chrome. You guys sound crazy until you ask, how do you protect the help desk crowd, right? And how do you protect, you know, all that? So
yeah,
then block that.
Because you can use, so for that you can use Chromium or something like that, and you don't have the Chrome extensions. At least it's something else you don't have.
Yeah, yeah, but that, the custom browser is a variation of that, right? So you can actually add extensions that protect them. Right.
Yeah,
so,
yeah. Just a question for you. Was I have the microphone? Did you at least contact those guys, the land sweeper guys, directly, and tell them like you should probably do something about it?
Well, didn't contact them. I think that they should. So,
yeah.
I proposed the fix for Augury in their GitHub, but I couldn't find any means to contact these guys, so they are very shady.
I'm not sure that will work, man, because I tried to do that as a feature and it wasn't available in the latest ones. So I actually wanted to execute.
So I should probably uninstall Augury and Batarang. But what do you think about Brave? Have you looked into that yet?
Excuse me?
Brave, the new browser.
Brave?
It's by Brendan, whatever his name is. Brave? No? It's a new browser, it's all JavaScript, Electron based.
Oh, you didn't hear him?
I didn't hear.
Oh,
okay. So he was asking, what do you think about the other browser, Brave, which is based on Electron?
Didn't hear about this browser.
Okay.
Should check it out.
Electron is scary. It's scary because you can execute the command. You got node, man.
Mm-hmm. Okay, any more questions? Okay, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
You have a payload in node.
Okay, guys, closing. Right, so those of you who forgot or didn't get a chance to copy the URL, bit.ly /free Node.js book. This is your free essential Node.js security book. All the slides will be published on OWASP.org, so don't worry. Okay. Please keep in touch with us via Twitter, Facebook, and we can watch recordings on YouTube, or talk to us on Slack. The next provisional date for the next meeting is 18th of May, which is also a Thursday, and that will happen straight after AppSec Europe, so I hope we get some speakers who can talk about the conference and maybe convince some of the speakers to present their talks at our event in London as well. Okay, so we would like to invite everyone to come and present their talks at our events. OWASP has three main tracks for talks, which is breakers, defenders, and builders track. So breakers is obviously stuff you break, right? So it's for pen testers, red teamers, right? Exploitations, like today's one that Arseny just presented, show you how to break browsers, security, hopelessly, and execute any command, including format your C drive, steal all your files, and say goodbye to all your data. Okay. Defenders track, which you can say about different defense scenarios, and builders track, when you can talk about different best practices, build guidelines, standards, and tools as well. So if you would like to speak, please do submit the abstract of your talk and your bio to owasplondon@owasp.org. Sharif and myself will look at it and invite you to one of our future events. So I would like to thank our speakers today, which is David Johnson, Kevin Delaney, and Arseny Reutov. Can you please give a round of applause for them? Many thanks for coming to the panel. And many thanks to Stefan Freeman and Telegraph Media Group for hosting us in this wonderful venue. Quick reminder, all slides will be published, so a reminder to speakers, please email me your slides so I can publish them. And thanks to you, Jonathan Dees, because without you, this event wouldn't be what it is. Thank you very much. And the next bit is networking in the pub. Right, so Stefan tells me this is the pub to go to, which is called the Victoria. And we just leave this building, we cross the road, then we turn right, and we turn left, and we'll see this place. Okay, so if you're coming, I'll see you there. Thank you very much. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you, everyone.
It's a bit of a challenge, because we can't have the users.